Good morning, everybody. Welcome to our webinar. I'm glad that we have people from many countries here today with us and from different segments of the market. We are here because we have to discuss a very important topic. COVID crisis has created an enormous trend towards the remote working. And although remote working proved to be easy to be adapted in business, it's a very serious and more deep business that most organizations can realize. So today we will try to approach this with a more structured way in order to help businesses to adapt to remote working while complying to various certification standards and security standards, but it is very important for the everyday working. So remote working is here to stay, and we have here Laszlo Strandler from Beyond Trust, who is going to discuss with us two serious use cases. One is how to give remote access to our privileged user inside in our organization, either if they are third vendor or they are internal employees. And secondly, how a support of the organization can work in a situation where we have to support from anywhere to anywhere. There is no parameter anymore. So we need to have a structured way to provide support and to have visibility from the management and on. So let me introduce you now our Laszlo Strandler, who is going to give us these two very serious topics. Help us to make the discussion as interactive as possible. You can ask questions. We will try to have it as much as possible interactive. So, Laszlo.
Hello, everyone. I'm Laszlo Strandler from Beyond Trust. As you see, I'm also working from home and from Germany. So in this new world, this is completely normal. But it's one thing that it works. It also needs to be secure. That's really important for a lot of you, I think. So we're going to talk about it, how to do it securely as well. Can you give me the right to present, please?
Place the ball to Laszlo.
Okay. Yes. So good morning, everyone, again. This is our agenda today. First, I will talk a bit about who Beyond Trust is. Maybe some of you haven't heard of us. And I'm going to talk a bit about our universal privilege management message. I'm going to mention our other products so you understand the big picture, but I'm going to concentrate on privileged remote access and remote support. Once I talked about it, I'm going to show you some of these use cases, and afterwards you will have time to ask questions and I'll try to answer them. Yes, so who is Beyond Trust? You see four companies here as puzzle pieces. Maybe you've heard about some of them. There used to be a company called Beyond Trust, but the Beyond Trust of today is made up of four companies. It was Bomgar, who is responsible for those two products that I'm going to talk about. Then it was Avecto, who did the endpoint privilege management solution, Beyond Trust, of course, and Lieberman. We merged because all of these companies had some really great products that can be used to protect privileged accounts or privileged sessions. And with this new portfolio, we can protect every session, every credential that you use to connect to your important and secure systems. Yes, so here's the slide that everyone shows. We have a lot of customers everywhere around the world. 72 of the Fortune 100 are of our customers. These are only the ones who allow us to show their logos. We have a lot more. So we hope that some of you will be our customers as well. Now, we've been recognized by the industry, and we are really proud to be a leader according to Gartner and Forrester. Recently, we received an award from SC Europe. It's also very important for us. We work with analysts like Kuppinger Kohl. We try to listen to them and to our customers and so be prepared for the future all the time. Here in this slide, you can also see that we're a Gartner leader and a Forrester leader. But you know, that doesn't mean anything if the products are not good and secure. But yes, I will show you that they are. Now, regarding this universal privilege management I talked about, why is it important to secure every part of the process? As we've seen, almost 80% of these breaches involved privileged credentials of some sort. So by not having a control of your privileged credentials, you basically let your adversaries into your network. A lot of companies don't really know who has access to these credentials. That's also not really a good thing. So you should always know that either who has access to them, who has what kind of rights, or if you're using one of our products, then you know that basically no one has direct access to them. They can only use them indirectly if they were given the rights. So the breach is always started either with privileged accounts or with normal accounts. That's also a way to get into systems. And the critical vulnerabilities, 77% of them can be mitigated by removing admin rights. And now we're talking about the endpoints. So that's also a very important thing. I will talk a bit about why that's important and how we can help there as well. So here you see our portfolio. I'm going to talk a bit about our other two product categories so you understand our big picture. We have a product called Privileged Password Management. We also call it Password Safe. That's our big password safe. We have an endpoint management solution, and we have our Secure Remote Access product. Now, this is the cyber attack chain. This is actually a shorter version of it, but that's the important thing. You've probably all seen it. What do attackers want to achieve? They first want to get into your systems. That's usually very easy for them. That way, they are inside. They still can't do much, but they try to escalate their privileges to become admins. And once they've become admins, they can do lateral movement, go to your other systems, to the crown jewels they are interested in, and then get out with that data. Now, if you use our products, we can help you to stop them from doing that. First of all, with our secure remote access products, we don't let them in. Of course, there are other ways to get in, but we don't let them in through unsecure products or unmanaged ones that a lot of companies use. So from that point of, you'll be secure. We help you remove your admin rights from the endpoint, and we don't give your people direct access to the domain admin rights, so they actually won't be able to do privileged escalation. We'll also, with our endpoint management tool, we block them from doing other ways of privileged escalation. And as they won't be able to find any credentials, they won't be able to laterally move in your systems. So if you use all our products, then you can protect the whole cyber attack chain. But today we're going to talk about the access products. Now, a bit about the password management. Our password vault, our password safe. This might be interesting for you. Although our secure remote access solutions have their own password vault, this is a much more powerful one. This lets you discover automatically and automatically onboard all the privileged accounts that are in your systems. Even if someone manages to create a new domain admin account, maybe an attacker or someone who has the rights but was not supposed to do that, we automatically see those accounts, onboard them, rotate the passwords. So even those unplanned accounts are in your systems, no one will be able to abuse them because no one will have access to those rights, only the people who should have access to those. We can manage who has access to those credentials, and we audit everyone who access those and see what they did in those sessions. And you can also use these credentials for your DevOps activities to connect to your cloud systems. So for everyone who has this need, it might be worthwhile to have a look at this product as well, or ask NSS about it. Now, there's another product, that's our endpoint privilege management solution, where we help you work without admin rights. What's really great about our product is that you don't need to wait months and look at logs to realize what everyone is using and create policies according to that. We have an out-of-the-box quick start policy that lets you work as you had admin rights, but actually without having them. We elevate the processes that you will need. And later, you can change those policies to be more restrictive if you want to. But in the end, what you will achieve is that you won't have admin rights on those machines. So your service desk and your administrators won't have admin rights, but they'll be able to do what they want. This is also a very important product to protect the cyber attack chain. And now we are back to our secure remote access pillar, the one that I'm going to talk about now. As we've mentioned, everyone is working from home office now, but even without home office, you'll have your vendors who are not, most of the time, not on site because they work at another company. They might even work in another country or another continent. So they need to access your systems remotely. And also your own users, if you need to support them. Even after COVID, if there will be something like that, they still, first of all, they will stay probably in their home offices because they realized how great that is, and you won't be able to take that away from them. And also, you have your employees who need to travel, and you will need to support them as well. So it's a very important topic. So we have these two products, remote support and privileged remote access. They are for different use cases, but they are based on the same code. So everything that I'm talking about one is probably the same for the other one. I'm going to tell you the differences though. So our topic today is privileged remote access. We think that's the most important thing for you, because you'll have your vendors who need to securely connect to your systems, but you also have your own administrators who need to do that. So the product is not only for external people. Now, why is that important? Big companies have an average of 182 vendors connecting to them each week. But you know, even one could be fatal if that's not controlled in the right way. And 3 out of 5 organizations mentioned that they had a breach done by a vendor. Maybe indirectly, but someone got in through them into those systems. So what are those risks and challenges that you face? First of all, you somehow need to manage those vendor accesses. Usually with other solutions, you first of all need to give them access in those solutions, and you also need to provide some kind of VPN access. You will use different systems to do that. These vendors will need passwords to access your systems, and either they will write them down on a paper or store them in an insecure password management solution. That's not ideal. Most of the time, if you use your previous solutions, you'll either give them access to everything or to nothing. Even if you think that you gave them access only to one part of the network, there they'll have a lot of ports to work with. So they can do more than you think. If you try to be secure about it, those processes can be complicated, and you and your vendors will spend more time with the processes than with actual work. So that's also not something you want. You want these processes to be secure, but efficient and easy. And also you have your compliance guidelines. So you need to record the sessions. You need to be able to see in logs who connected to what system, when and why. And your previous solutions might not be able to do that. So what can we do, and how can we help you with our privileged remote access solution? This one allows you to connect to your systems without VPN. That's also important for the vendors and also for your own employees. So what's the issue with VPN? First of all, it's another system that you need to manage. You need to give access to your vendors to this system as well. You might forget that you gave access, even if one of their employees leaves. But also, VPNs are really unsecure. A couple of years ago, we thought that VPNs are the best thing that happened to us. It lets everyone in securely to systems, but that's not the case. You've probably heard that almost all big VPN vendors had critical security holes in their systems in the last couple of years. And a lot of companies were hacked through these. In Germany, a couple of weeks ago, someone even died. They couldn't go to the hospital because they were hacked through a VPN solution and they had to be transferred to another hospital and they died on the way. So it can be a really serious issue. With our solution, you can give people access securely, but without a VPN. Now, another thing you can do is use our onboard password vault or connect to our big one that we mentioned previously, that I mentioned previously. And this password, this vault lets your vendors access your systems without having access to those passwords. They just choose from a list, inject those credentials into the sessions, they have access, and after the session is over, you can have those passwords automatically rotated. You don't need to give access to them all the time. You can specify when they are allowed to connect, and you can specify which systems they are allowed to connect. You can also include a workflow where you need to approve that they want to connect. So even if you give them access to specific systems, they still get your approval that they can come in. Everything that they do will be monitored. We log every activity, we log every session. You will even be able to check in real time what they are doing. But if you're not doing that, you will be able to see those logs. And we also integrate with your existing tools, like your ITSM and change management tools. So you even might be able to let them in if they have an active change assigned to them. The possibilities are endless here. I'm going to mention some of the ways that you can use this product to give access to your systems. First of all, we have an agent that you can install. If there is no reason not to, then we prefer it because it comes with some extra features. But if you are not ready to install an agent or are not allowed to install an agent, then we have other ways to connect. We can use RDP to connect to your systems, SSH, or even VNC. You will be able to use the console that I'm going to show you later, or you can directly connect to your ticketing systems from your change management systems as well. So the administrator that got assigned a change can simply click on a button in the change management system and start a session to the system. And you can also invite someone if you receive the right to invite someone. That's a really interesting feature. Now I'm going to talk about the infrastructure, how it works. This is the same for both products. So what I'm going to talk about here, that's also for remote support. Now, security is very important for us. So these products were built with security in mind. These are appliance based. It doesn't matter where you deploy those appliances, you get the same security and same feature set. These appliances, so you can deploy them as hardware. We still have some customers who want to have hardware. So if you're one of them, you can buy hardware and deploy them that way. You can deploy them virtually to Hyper-V or VMware. You can put them yourselves into the cloud, into Azure, AWS, or Google, or you can get software as a service from us, if that's what you prefer. The big difference between us and other vendors is that our software as a service solution is not a multi-tenant one. You get your own appliance that's managed by us, but we can't access it. So you're the only one who has access to it. You have to give us access if you want us to support it. And even if someone manages to hack one of our customers and get into their appliance, there's no way to access other customers' data because they are separate appliances in separate sessions. Now, the appliance is deployed somewhere where it has internet access. You can deploy it internally if you want to, but then you'll have to use a VPN. And as I mentioned, that's very bad. So you don't want that. You have your technicians who connect to the appliance. They use port 443 and a TLS 1.3 encryption. Now you have your endpoints. Let's say a Windows server where you install the agent. That also connects to the appliance. Again, port 443 and TLS encrypted. Now, as you see, all the connections are done to the appliance. The appliance never creates connections the other way around. This is very important for security, but it's also great for you because there's not much that you need to open on your firewalls. So basically, you need to open port 443 to the appliance, and that's it. There's nothing else you need. The solution is also really secure because it's been hardened, and it comes with the DNS name that you give us burnt into it. So no one can change it. No one can redirect those sessions to somewhere else. And also the components that you need, your consoles, your agents, you download them from the appliance itself, from your appliance, not from a website that's available for everyone. And those components have the DNS name burnt in as well. So your components can only connect to your appliance and not to one of your competitors. Yes, that was a connection using the agent. But what if you don't want to use an agent? You can deploy this piece somewhere in your network. We call it jump server, jump point. This one creates a connection to the appliance, again, port 443 and TLS encrypted. And inside that network where it's been deployed, it can create an RDP connection for you, even an HTTPS connection if you are using PRA. So you can even give access to a web console of your firewall, of your switch, or whatever system to someone. Or you can use VNC or SSH. And if you're talking about end user support, your end users that you are supporting can, of course, sit at home. They can use Windows, Mac, Linux, Chrome OS. They can use mobile devices as well. We support those as well. And even your administrators, it doesn't matter which product we're talking about. They can use everything that's possible. It doesn't matter what OS they are using. We even give you access to a web console that you can use. And if you want that, you can use your iPad to connect to your Exchange server by sitting in your sofa. So everything's possible and still secure. All right, now that was PRA. And now I'm going to talk a bit about remote support. So as I said, it works the same way. There are some feature differences, like you don't have the approval workflow here, and you can't connect to websites, web consoles, but you will have other features here that are more suited for remote support. What are the challenges that help desks face today? That's inefficiency. For help desks, efficiency is really important. Security is also important, but that only comes after efficiency. You want your agents to be able to connect to the ones they support really easily. I've seen support scenarios where even at big companies, where the support agents simply couldn't connect. I've seen that here at home happening to my wife. She works at a big company. They tried to give her remote access, but failed. They wanted to connect remotely to her computer, but failed. Yeah, you don't really want to do that. You want these support connections to work the first time. You ideally want to solve the issue in the first session. And if you can't connect, that's not going to work. You also want to be able to collaborate. If first level needs to transfer a session to second level or needs help from a colleague, you want to be able to do that with the same solution. Chatting in another tool, asking them to call the user, is not really efficient. You want that to happen in the same session, in the first one. You want to be, you want these tools to be integrated in your ticketing system. Maybe you want to start the session from the ticketing system as well, or you want all the logs, all the screenshots that you create, get into the ticketing system. You don't want to do that later, after the session. Scalability is also important. Your organizations grow. You will work with more sites that you haven't worked before. So you want this tool to be able to help you with that as well. You don't necessarily want to give everyone the same access. Your first level agents don't need to have access to some of those tools and some of those systems that your second level agents have. So that's also very important. But of course, as we are a security company, security is important for us. The system needs to be secure. Others shouldn't be able to get into your systems through that. And you also want to audit everything that happens. You want to have a video recording of your sessions. That's everything that you can do with our remote support. So again, as with VPN, as with PRA, you can use it without a VPN. Of course, if your use case is that you need to deploy it in your network without access from the outside, that's possible. But in today's world, you want to support your employees sitting in their home offices and without using a VPN. That works. You want to monitor everything. You want to have session recordings. You want to have an audit trail, logs, where connected, where and for how long. That's also important for your metrics in this solution. You want to know how long your sessions were to you know, refine your processes maybe. Now, we also include chat support. Maybe you want your agents to work on several cases at the same time. By being on the phone, that's not really possible, but there are some issues that you can solve simply by chatting. That way they can chat with several customers, several users at the same time. And some of them, where they really need to connect to the systems and call them, they can elevate it to a full support session. You can even use chatbots here. You might have a chatbot that automatically talks to your users, but after a while, it realizes that it can't help them. It then automatically gives the session over to one of your human agents with all the history that's been talked about. Now, as we are living in an age of smartphones, you can even share the camera of your smartphone. So you might have a user at home who has problems with their laptops. They don't know where they need to plug in a cable, which button they need to press. But if they have a smartphone, you can connect to that. They can share their camera. You see what they see. You can draw on that image and tell them which button to press. You can use that feature also in your data center to show your technicians where to plug in a network cable, where to put in a new hardware appliance. And of course, we can integrate with your ticketing and CRM systems. Now, as I mentioned, efficiency is very important for companies. You get that benefit with our tool. You will be able to maximize the value of your existing solutions, like your ITSM systems. You'll increase your security and you'll have an audit trail and see what happened everywhere.
Since we are talking about integration, there is a question here if it can be integrated with Dynamics CRM.
Probably. I will check that for you. Whether we have an out of the box integration. But even if we don't have an out of the box integration, you can still integrate with everything. We have our APIs, and with our APIs, you can connect to every other system that that has the API capability. Let me check it.
Okay, let's go and we will see and answer this question afterwards.
Yes, so I don't think we have an out of the box integration, but you will be able to integrate it with the APIs. We have a really great documentation for that. Yes, so you know, numbers are really important, especially when we are talking about metrics. And we've asked our customers who use our remote support tools what they achieved with that. 85% of them had an increased of first closure rate. They were really happy about that. They increased their customer satisfaction. They increased their agent productivity. even their agents were very satisfied with the solution. That's very important. So you want your employees to have access to tools that they like to use. If they don't have that, then they look for other ways to help themselves, and that's not great for security. And they managed to reduce incident handling time.
I can tell you my experience here, because it was the very first product of Beyond Trust that I use it. You know, during the first lockdown situation, I had to support at home my wife and my two children that had to do Teams. And because it was the first time that they were doing this work, they needed a lot of help with my firewall, with my things that they have to manage. So I used remote support to support them, and all of them were happy. I use everything, phone, camera. So it's a very easy tool to integrate, but gives a lot of managerial tools that are necessary for the enterprises. So it is an enterprise level product, but also very easy to work with.
Yes, so once I'm in the demo, I'm going to show you how easy that is. So there's one last thing. I want to tell you, I'm also going to show you that. So the difference between PRA and remote support is that remote support has a portal, has a support portal that you can use to start sessions. You can install the agent as with PRA. So if you are supporting your own company, then you can deploy agents to all your users' computers and just need to look for them in a list, click on it and connect, and that's it. And if you don't want to do that, then you can use a support portal and use that to connect to the people you want to support. Those might be not your employees. You might support externals. So you'll need a ticketing, so you'll need support portal, but you will also be able to use your ticketing system, as I mentioned, to start sessions from there. And that was
Before we go to demo, we need to have some question answer from the audience in order to let you time. There was a question if there is this model as an MSP. The answer is yes, and we can communicate later with you about this question. There is another question regarding for RDS. If
sorry, George, I don't hear what you're saying.
If Microsoft license for RDS are required, or the remote session is established using the agent or other method?
Regarding the agent, it's not required. Regarding RDP, it might be required. So if you want to do RDP connections and you don't want to install a freeware RDP tool, then you will have you'll need RDP licenses. Now, you know, that's again only important if you want to have several connections to the same system. As far as I know, if you just want to connect to one person wants to connect to one system, that might work without the license. We have customers who use RDP on Linux by installing a freeware or open source RDP tool. And there you don't need licenses by Microsoft. I hope I answered the question.
And last question regarding Windows cases. Does the program bypass UAC so agent can gain admin rights?
Yes, that's a really great question. We can, and I will show you how.
Okay, so Feel free to ask questions. We can interrupt during the time, so but we try to find the right time slot in order to put that. Okay.
Yes.
So let's.
Okay. So the first use case I want to show you is how a vendor can connect to your systems. So let's say I'm a vendor now. I logged in to the console. It could have been a web console if I don't want to or are not allowed to install it, although it doesn't require admin rights. So even someone who doesn't have admin rights should be able to do that. Of course, as a vendor, there was a second factor integrated, two-factor authentication. So I might have entered a code next to my password or might have pressed my mobile phone to give me access. So we have those integrations. But now I'm in. And I have a system here that I want to connect. And I click on it and try to connect. But there's an approval workflow here. So before I can connect, I need to supply a reason. And I also need to request a specific time frame. I might want to connect during the weekend. So I can request the approval for the future. But at the moment, I want to connect now, and I'm sure that 1 hour will be enough. So I only request access for 1 hour. I click on it, and an email will be sent to the approval. Now I'm also the approval here, and I received an email. It tells me that there's this external who wants to connect to that system during that time for this reason. And then I can decide whether I want to approve that. Of course I do now. Because I approved it, this now turned green and they have access to connect. They start the session, and as I mentioned, they don't have any credentials. If you're not using the Vault, there's an option to provide those credentials, but we are using it and they don't need to have direct access to those credentials. They just choose the one that they need. It could help. Yes?
We have a question here. What about if they have already a password vault, let's say from Phycotic, can we support a third party password vault?
I mean, we'd prefer if you would use ours. You might be able to work with the APIs. But we can't promise you that it works because password vaults are, you know, not as open as other systems or APIs.
Okay, so but we have to check the supporting list, especially for the password vault.
Yes, so Phycotic might work. Phycotic might.
Yes, I have a comment that yes. Audience that Phycotic is on the support list.
Yes, it's on the
so on this situation we have to check the support list. I suppose to see that let's say Phycotic is working out of the box and supported, and also our own vault. Okay.
Yes. So that's the difference. So when we talk about ITSM systems, with the APIs, we'll be able to do everything. Password vaults, you know, that depends on the other side whether they want you to connect to other systems with that. So yeah. So now, as this is a Windows server, I'm using these credentials. But if I already connected to this system, it remembers the credentials that I've used. I start the connection and it injects the credentials and I'm in. I don't know the password, but I could connect to the system and I can work here. So that was me as an external. Now let's say I stopped the session, but then I realized, hey, I still want to do something. I still have the approval working and I can reconnect. Okay, so that was me as a vendor, as a third party. But let's say I'm an internal and I want to connect to a system. I can start the connection and I don't need an approval workflow. As we're now not using RDP, but our agent, you need to inject the credentials now, but it will work the same way. And we are inside the session. So the big difference here is that as an internal, I probably have the rights to invite other people into the session. The vendor probably won't have those rights. So I can show you how that works. I create an invitation. I can specify what kind of rights I want to give someone I invited. This way, I'm going to give only view only rights, and I create a link that I can send by email. The one I wanted to invite receives this link, clicks on it. As this is only for a one-time session, they do not want to install anything. They want to go, connect from the web browser, and they are inside the session. As I didn't give them rights, they can only see. They can maybe chat with me, but they won't have the rights to control anything. A use case for this is if you need to have support from a third party connect to your systems, but it wasn't planned. You just call them and you want to give them access fast, and it needs to be really secure. So you might use this feature. And what of course makes it secure as well is that if you close this session, they get logged out. Now I'm going to show you how a remote support session will work. Okay. So let's say here is my support portal. I am a user that needs to be supported. You can customize this portal and remove everything that you don't need. If you are a smaller help desk, then you might want to have a list of your supporters who are logged into the session and simply can click on them. You can choose from a list of issues that you supply yourself, and you can then get connected to the agent that deals with that session. But let's stay with the standard way. We're in a call and I generate a session key. I give that session key to you. You import it, input it. started, it downloads a small executable. Start the executable and it starts the session. Now at this point, I don't even want to connect. I can use the messages that I already put there. Maybe I ask them whether they've Googled the issue. They receive those chat messages and everything will be logged. And then I decide that I need to connect to them. They will be, of course, asked. You can set it up the way you'd like to. But after that, I'm connected. And I can do almost everything at this point other than UACs. So that's what someone asked me. The system even tells me that this session is running in a limited user context and it needs to be elevated if I want to have access to UAC prompts. I simply click on this one and I have several options. I can use my own admin credentials to elevate the process. I can use the vault again. Or in this case, as this is my lab and my user has admin rights, which shouldn't be the case out there, but yes, I was lazy and it's a lab. I simply prompt the user. And they get the message, they get the UAC prompt, they click on it, the session will be restarted, I reconnect in the same session, and now it's running with system rights, so it can interact with UAC prompts. It's that easy. If you have the agent pre-installed, then it's not an issue because it's already running with those rights. It's only important for ad hoc connections. Of course, there are a lot of extra tools here that I didn't show you today. There's one thing I want to show. You can include some of your own tools where you just simply click on them. It will be copied over to the system. Started, for example, these are these internal tools, and once you close them and finish the session, those will be deleted, so you don't really leave anything behind. As with the other tool, you will be able to invite others in the session, so you will be able to move the session, give the session to someone, or you will be able to invite others into the session. So you might want a second level to help you out, but you don't want to transfer the session. You want it to be this one session, but they can still connect into your session and help you out. And as I mentioned, that we also do recordings. This is the video of the first session I did. And so you'll be able to watch the videos of the sessions. There was not really much I did here. But you'll also have text-based logging. Okay, that was the demo. That was what I wanted to show. Do you have any questions?
There is a question regarding, we were mentioning before that one of the differences of remote support is that they don't support web access, web interfaces.
Yes.
So what if they have access to a PC that has access, let's say, to web interface of a firewall? Is this a workaround in order to, let's say, to go to a web
Of course. So whatever you do on that system that you connect to, it's up to you. So you know the reason behind it. So these two tools, one of them is meant for your infrastructure, for your administrator, where you manage your servers, where you manage your firewalls, where you have third parties connecting in. So those are the features that the product has. It doesn't have the support portal. It doesn't do ad hoc connection to endpoints. That's something that your support needs. And most of the time, you don't want to use the same system for these two departments. That's not a nice thing to say, but that's what I see quite often, especially in big companies. These different departments, they don't really like each other. They don't really like to work together. They don't talk. And if everyone has a separate system, everyone's better off. They can play around with it. They can change it the way they want. They have their recordings in it, not from the other team. So yeah, there's a reason that these two systems are separate.
I don't know if we have answered the question of Steven, but he's insisting on asking about the difference of remote support and privileged remote mm-hmm. access. We can do a separately session in order to explain to you more details about this, but we are talking about two different cases. One is for the support team and the other is for IT. The features are almost similar, but they are totally distinguished as use cases.
Yes. Yes. So actually, most of the time, you will be able to use one solution for everything. So the big differences are that remote support has this support portal where you can do ad hoc connection to clients. But it doesn't have the workflow capability. So where you need, as I said, where you can approve a connection. And it doesn't have the capability to connect directly to websites. That's what PRA does. Those are the two big differences. But you know, if you are not sure, NSS or we will have a look at your use cases and we'll have to figure you out which product is best for you.
Okay, we will have a deeper discussion on this because, you know, the differences are very sensitive, and it's better to discuss together.
Yes. Everyone's a bit different, so we'll have to look at those use cases and decide which one is the better fit.
Okay, I don't know if we have any other question. We are free and open for questions right now. There is always ability to perform evaluation if needed to see on your own environment, and of course we can help you before doing an evaluation to understand if what we are offering is addressing your issue. It's very easy. You just have to communicate with us in order to discuss with you about your use case and find the correct way. In general, what we can say right now is that remote working is here to stay. We need it even after the COVID situation that everybody is hoping that it's going to be soon over. But the digital acceleration of remote working is here to stay. So we need to have a structured way in providing remote working and remote support. All these working habits are here to stay, and it has affected a lot the businesses. Now the office are are not necessary as they were before. Companies are downsizing their offices because they find that they can have people at home working and have the same productivity. So we are available for you in order to discuss any of you may have any issue to address, and we hope that we can be of your help and find the correct solution for you with you. Again, the privilege access part is a part that you, most of the time is having a lot of approaches, but we are sure that we can find your correct approach, even if you are a small or medium company or a very complex organization that perhaps needs to address this issue with several products. So, and what Laszlo has said in the beginning, all these nice tools that Beyond Access is providing, they are through the unified management console. So it doesn't matter how complex an environment can be and perhaps needs several products of Beyond Access portfolio, all this can be done and managed by the unified management, which is the vision actually of Beyond Trust, but it's making this collaboration easier and very easy to people working on the solution to have a single pane of glass. Okay, thank you for your time today. We will send everybody the presentation, and we are available to you for questions either now or perhaps with a private email if you need something more specific.
Thank you for your time, and I hope I talk to some of you after this. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.